हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ वेटनरी मेडिसिन। डॉक्टर बंसल कंप्लीटेड हिज बीबीएससी एंड एमबीएससी फ्रॉम लुधियाना वेटनरी कॉलेज अंडर द जेनेसिस ऑफ पीएयू एंड फॉर हिज पीएचडी ही वाज ऑन कॉमन अलायंस फ्रॉम पंजाब एग्रीकल्चर यूनिवर्सिटी हैड बीन टू यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ वेटनरी मेडिसिन हैनोवर जर्मनी एंड ही डिड हिज पीएचडी अगेन इन मैस्टाइटिस फ्रॉम जर्मनी। डॉक्टर बंसल स्टार्टेड हिज इनिशियल कैरियर एज अ वेटनरी ऑफिसर अंडर पंजाब एनिमल हस्बेंड्री सो ही इज वेल अवेयर ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम्स दैट अ फील्ड वेट फेसेस। लेटर ऑन ही जॉइंड हिज कैरियर एज असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ वेटनरी मेडिसिन गॉट एलिवेटेड एज एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर एंड वॉज हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट टिल 2016। इन 2016 ही टुक ओवर एज डायरेक्टर ऑफ लाइफ स्टॉक फार्म्स कडवासो एंड इज करेंटली ऑल्सो प्लेइंग अ pivotal role in that current position. He is a prominent academician, a researcher with more than 120 publications in referred journals, more than 130 research articles presented during various conferences. He is not only an Indian vet, he also represents us in various global forums. He is a firm believer of implementing research at the grassroots level. So he has been working extensively on the extension area. He has delivered more than 300 lectures during farmer training programs and published number of articles in Punjabi magazines for the farmers. Truly at heart, Dr. Bansal is a learner. He has been participating in various symposiums and seminars, both nationally and internationally. He is a regular delegate and participant and speaker to World Bioethics Congress, International Conference on Production Diseases, IDF International Mastitis Conference, Buffalo, World Buffalo Conference, to name a few. My words will fall short if I have to describe Dr. Bansal, but he is a person with numerous calibers. He has contributed a lot to the profession. He has lots of awards and laurels to his credit. He is the proud recipient of Fellowship of Indian Society of Veterinary Medicine in 2014, Indian Academy of Veterinary Science in 2010, and he is also the DC Blood Gold Medal awardee from Indian Society of Veterinary Medicine. With deep respect, I welcome Dr. Bansal to enlighten us and share his expertise on bovine mastitis and its management. Let me again say, Dr. Bansal is someone who has spent his entire life on mastitis, has learned and experienced mastitis in and out. So over to Dr. Bansal for his session on bovine mastitis. Dr. Bansal, sir.
So thank you, Dr. Nitin Bhatia, for nice words. So at the onset, I am thankful to Intas Animal Health for providing me this opportunity to share my knowledge with my fellow vets throughout India. So I welcome all the participants of this webinar. And I will, in the next 1 hour, I will try to share my knowledge, my learning on this topic of mastitis management in dairy animals with my fellow colleagues. So, coming to the bovine mastitis, what is mastitis? So theoretically, we all know it is an inflammation of the mammary glands in which there are physical and chemical changes in the milk and usually bacteriological changes. I say usually bacteriological changes because my field veterinarians, my brothers, they know when sometimes they send the milk samples for the culturing, but many times this no bacteria is coming. And on the other hand, when we have the milk samples from healthy udders and when we are doing culturing, we get some bacteria. So that is why it is said usually bacteriological changes. But nowadays it is more reliable, it is more recommended to define mastitis in terms of evidence of inflammation, which is the somatic cells, leukocytes. Now these leukocytes from the blood, whenever there is any injury to the udder or there is any inflammation, the leukocytes from the blood, they come into the milk and their number increases in the milk. In the milk, these leukocytes are referred as somatic cells. So somatic, it is included in the definition of the mastitis. Now, as per International Dairy Federation, they say we should use both combination of bacteriological culture and somatic cell count. And when it is both culturally positive and cell count is more than 5 lakhs, we say it as specific mastitis. Now, when culturally negative means we are not able to isolate the bacteria, but it is having high cell count, definitely it is abnormal quarter, definitely there is some abnormality with the quarter, so we can say it as non-specific mastitis. On the other hand, when we isolate the bacteria, but there is no high cell count, so then it can be a latent infection, or it can be an initial infection, or it can be a teat canal infection. And we have seen that these latent infections usually do not have any pathological implication for the glandular tissues. Although later on they may establish and they may lead to the glandular changes. And by definition, a quarter is considered as healthy when there is no culture and cell count is less than the defined limits. Now, from field point of view, from treatment point of view, we divide mastitis into primarily into two categories, clinical, subclinical. As the name indicates, clinical, when there are visible abnormalities in the secretion. Now, one we coming across in the field with veterinarians, they are coming across with the treatment in the hospitals, when there are secretions, owner is coming with some complaint that there is a decrease in the milk yield, there are flakes in the milk, or there is a change in the color of the milk, or sometimes they are observing the change in the udder tissue. It may be inflamed, it may be hard, it may be atrophied, or there may be some swelling. So when there are visible abnormalities, it is a clinical. So on the other hand, when there is no visible abnormalities, but we indirectly diagnose some inflammation of the evidence through high cell count or through some other chemical changes, then it is said as subclinical. In this, there will be no visible clinical signs. Now, from treatment point of view, clinical is further divided into three categories, percute, acute, chronic. Now, percute, it is a very sudden in onset. There is a utter inflammation, and there is a systemic reactions. Now it develops within few minutes post-calving. The owner says that he has milked or she has milked the cow, it was normal. But within few hours, the udder has become inflamed, it has become red, hot, painful to touch, and there is a fever to the animal. Fever, animal has started stopping eating, animal is in depression or it is dull, and animal, sometimes animal may become recumbent. So such kind of cases, they are percute cases, which is also sometimes they are wrapping it as gangrene mastitis, which later on may lead to the gangrene. So these are the emergency cases. So in books, they are taken as emergency, as if snake bite or as if percute blot. So this is the percute cases. They occur less commonly, but they, whenever they occur, they are very fatal, and usually they occur after in the post-calving period, immediately post-calving. 2 to 3 days post-calving period, and also in the July, August, when there is a more humid, hot climate. Now these acute, now 80%, 90% of the cases which we are coming across in the field, they are of the acute nature. There is a udder inflammation, there are visible abnormalities in the milk, but there is no systemic reaction. Animal is eating normal, animal appears normal, but only changes are limited to the udder and milk. So these are the most of the cases we are coming across in the field, they are of acute nature. Then chronic, when there is a formation of fibrocord, some nodules they are formed, or there is a recurrence, when the mastitis case is occurring again and again in the same teeth, it is occurring more than 3 times, or sometimes there is a thick pus discharge, only thick discharge is coming, pus is coming. So such cases, they are referred as chronic mastitis. Now, coming to just brief introduction, what is the status of this disease in India? So when we took average of the public publications, we found that in throughout India, in 47% of the cows may be having mastitis in one or more quarters at subclinical level. And in buffaloes, it may be up to 33% of the animals may be affected. Whereas for the clinical cases, when we go to the farms, per 100 cows, we at a time, we may be observing 6 to 7 cases on an average. And in buffaloes, it may be 3 to 6 cases or 4 to 6 cases. And these animals, they may have 1 to 2 quarters affected. Some animals may have 1 quarter affected, others may have 2 quarter affected. And it's very rare that 3 or 4 quarters are affected. and almost it is the nil chance that animal will be having all the four quarters affected with the mastitis. Throughout my experience, I have never seen such cases that all the four quarters are involved. But sometimes veterinarian do come to us and they say, this animal is having, we are going for testing of sample, this animal is having all the four quarters affected with the mastitis. But when we test and when we examine, it is some other problem. The animal may be in the late lactation, or animal may be having only milk of 0.5 kg or 1 kg, less than 200 gram per quarter. Now, when it is less than 200 grams, it is not a milk, it is a normal secretion, or it may be due to the very prolonged lactation, but we are coming across. So whenever you come across in the field with the complaint of mastitis in all the four quarters, please examine those from all angles due to some other disease, due to some decreased disease or over-lactation, because it is almost rare, very, very rare that we will be having mastitis in all the four quarters. Now, when we go for the clinical pattern, culture pattern, 80% of the cases, they are caused by the staphylococcal mastitis. So this is a major culprit in Indian conditions, not only under Indian condition, even in the other parts of the world also, staphylococcus, it may be a coagulase negative staph, it may be a staphylococcus aureus. So majority of the cases which you are coming across in the field, they are of the staphylococcus nature. Then other bacteria like cyanobacteria, gram-negative, E. coli, few cases due to pseudomonas, they may also be reported, or some other bacteria, it may be bacillus, so they may be there. But primarily, it is a staphylococcus. Now, when we come across for the clinical cases, majority of the cases, many cases, they come during the hot, humid climate of July to September, October, when there is a hot and humid climate, and they are comparatively less number in case of winter months. And staphylococcus is present throughout the year, whereas these E. coli cases, percute mastitis cases, they are occurring mostly during July-August. When there are this bacteria, there are two reasons, because of this hot humid climate, due to the environmental wetting, due to the lack of cleanliness, there is a more source of infection of E. coli. And secondly, animals are recently calved. There are more calving during July-August month, and post-calving, animal immunity is compromised and animal gets more infections for this, and there are more chances of getting percute mastitis during these July-August months. Now, then we estimated the economic implications for this mastitis depending upon the prevalence of the disease and taking the milk price and all that, and we had found that in India, it resulted about 8-9 years back, it resulted into economic losses of more than 7,000 crores. And out of this major losses, they come due to the subclinical mastitis, because it is a hidden form of the disease, it is not diagnosed, and it affects more number of the animals, more number of the quarters. And in subclinical mastitis, there may be a 10 to 25% loss. Whereas when a quarter becomes affected with the clinical disease, there will be a total loss. Almost all the milk yield is lost from that affected quarters. And even if we treat that quarter, during that lactation, we could not receive more than 50% of the production. Only it can be in the next lactation, but during that particular lactation, if we receive more than 50-60%, then it is very good if we are able to cure the quarter. Now, this is how, when the, I told you these cell counts, they are evidence of the inflammation. So now when the loss of the milk production in subclinical mastitis, it may be correlated with the cell count, high cell count up to 25% loss. And by one definition, it is said that when a somatic cell count doubles starting from 50,000, a cow loses about 700 grams of milk. So with every 50,000 increase in the cell count, there will be a loss of 700 grams of milk. Now, how this affects the composition, how it occurs the mastitis. Now, in almost practically in more than 95% cases, this mastitis occurs by the entry of the bacteria through the teat canal. It may be at the milking time, it may be from the environment, post-milking. So when bacteria enters into the mammary gland, into the duct, either it may be eliminated by the teat defense, by the animal defense mechanisms. If not eliminated, it is adheres to the mammary gland epithelium. It releases toxins and irritants, and it causes two types of pathogenesis. One, it damages the glandular tissue, where milk is synthesized, where lactose is synthesized, where milk protein casein is synthesized, where fat is synthesized. So due to the damage to the gland, all these components, they decreases. On the other hand, it causes the damage to the vascular epithelium, alveolar epithelium. There is an increase in the vascular permeability, and due to the some components from the blood when it is circulating around the udder to around the gland, due to the loosening of the alveolar epithelium, leukocytes, they come from the blood into the milk, so which are referred as somatic cell count. So there is an increase in the somatic cell count. Bicarbonates are, they come from the blood into the milk, so it would lead to the rise in the pH. Sodium and chloride ions from the blood, they come into the milk. So this, when there are more ions in the milk, then there will be more ability to conduct the electricity, electric conductance. So there is an increase in the electrical conductivity of the milk. So this is used in the diagnosis of the mastitis, because more ions, more electrical conductivity. So then blood proteins, bovine serum albumin, it comes from the blood into the milk, which are referred as whey proteins. So, and potassium, to maintain the equilibrium, it goes out from the udder to the milk. Similarly, to some extent, lactose may also go out. So as a result, what happens, desirable components, it may be lactose, it may be proteins, milk proteins, fat, calcium, they decrease. Undesirable components, bacteria, cell counts, pH, electrical, sodium chloride ions, they increase. Now, you can see, this is a cell count limit, 100,000 cells, 1 lakh cells per ml. Now the component, they start, chloride start increasing at this level, sodium increasing at this level. Similarly, yield start decreasing after 100,000 cells per ml of milk sample. Similarly, lactose start decreasing, whey proteins increasing, potassium start decreasing. So this cell count limit, this is a physiological threshold limit. At 100,000 cells per a normal milk, we should not have cell count more than 1 lakh cells per ml of milk sample. Now, this is another slide you can find. This is at the normal milk is if 100,000 cells per ml of milk sample. Now, bovine serum albumin increases more than 2 times in case of high cell count in case of mastitic milk. Sodium increases by more than 100%, 50%, 75%. Similarly, this whey protein increases. These chloride, they increases by 50%. Potassium decreases to some extent. Calcium comes down less than 50%. Lactose, almost 10% decrease. Casein decreases. Fat decreases. So good components, they decrease. Undesirable components, they increase in milk. So that is why we said this cell count should be taken as, 1 lakh cell count should be taken as physiological threshold. And our milk is certainly normal when it has milk cell count of 2 lakh cells or more than the from a quarter. Now, this is again how this blood, it damage the mammary gland epithelium, bicarbonates enters into the pH and there is a rise in the pH, and this pH rise, it decreases the activity of proteolytic enzyme. So this has a severe implications for the dairy industry, because when in the dairy industry many products are made, then there is a clotting of the milk is done, and due to rise in pH, it is affected. So it affects the manufacturing process. Similarly, fat rancidity also increases in the milk from the mastitis case. Because of this, these leukocytes, they release the lipolytic enzyme. When there is more leukocytes, more lipolytic enzyme, and they damage the milk fat globule membrane, and it degrades the milk globule membrane, and it exposes the milk triglycerides. And these triglycerides, they are being acted upon by the milk lipoprotein lipase enzyme from the bacteria. So it will result into the elevated level of free fatty acids, which gives the rancid flavor to the milk. So rancid flavor milk can be detected in at a cell of more than 4 lakh cells per ml of milk samples. Then after the dairy industry, after the farmer, it has a significant implications for the consumer. There is a high risk of pathogens, because whenever there is an udder infection, there will be more bacteria. So there will be total bacterial count more. And more than 50% of the violations, they come due to the mastitis when we are considering the total bacterial count of the milk. Similarly, there is a high risk of drug residues. Now, when there is at a farm, suppose at a farm, when there is a more cell count, 4 lakh cells, then there will be more use of antibiotics. So then more use of antibiotics, then there are chances that we get more antibiotics in the milk. So 60% of the violations in the mastitis occurs due to the at the farm where there is a cell count of more than 4 lakh, and relative risk increases by 7.14 when cell count goes to the more than 7 lakh. So mastitis is a culprit for the public health significance implications also. So this is the normally a cow, milk brown cow should not contain more than 1000 colony forming unit per milk year. But when it is a mastitic animal, it may shed more than 10 million bacteria per ml. So even if we mix milk from one cow in a 100 cow herd from a mastitic cow, it may result into cell bacterial count of more than 100,000 colony forming unit per ml. So this is how it is affecting the quality of the milk, bacterial count of the milk. And when we have both high cell count in milk and high bacterial count in the milk, so this means this is coming from the udder. But otherwise, if we have a low cell count but high bacterial count, then it may be a post-milking contamination, because cell count is the source of cell count is only the udder, not the other. But bacterial contamination may take place in the post-milking phase also. Now, due to this importance of this SMET in the developed countries, it may be a Germany, in Europe, and in other developed countries, it may be in New Zealand, this SMETic cell count is used as a legal, voluntary standard for milk quality. So they are paying the price on the basis of the bulk tank milk SMETic cell count, on the basis of the farm milk SMETic cell count. So they incentives are paid on the basis, or some penalties are also put on that basis. Then the SMETic cell count is used as a decisive factor for food safety. Because I told you that when there is a more cell count, there will be more drug residues, there will be more bacteria, there may be more rancidity of the milk. So it is when high cell count is there, this means it has an altered composition. So it is used in the food safety factor also. Then it is used as a management tool for the farm in udder health, in animal welfare. Suppose at a one farm, we have a 10 lakh cell count per ml of milk sample. At other farm, we have a 1 lakh. So definitely at 10, where it is a 10 lakh, so we will be having more mastitis cases. Then why we are having more mastitis cases? This means cows, they are not properly managed. Animal welfare is not properly undertaken. Proper cleanliness is not undertaken. Proper housing is not taken. Proper milking machine function is not undertaken. That is why, due to this, more cases of mastitis are occurring. When more cases of mastitis are occurring, this means more cell count is there. The animal welfare is less. So it is taken as a farm management tool also. So by measuring the cell count of farm in the milk, we can diagnose or we can assess all these things. So German bulk tank milk SMETic cell count should not be more than 1 lakh cells per ml. European Union for legal purposes uses it as 4 lakhs, international regulation 5 lakh, but it is desirable to less than 2. Now, in one study in Punjab at dairy farm, we studied hundreds of dairy farms, and we had found that in case of cow farms, average milk swell count comes to be the 5,75,000. And 47% of the farms, they have cell count of more than 400,000 cells, 4 lakh. And 30%, one third of the farms, they have less than 2 lakh cells per ml of milk sample. Similarly, in buffaloes, average cell count came to be 3,68,000. And 55% of the farms, they have a less than 2 lakh cell count per ml of the milk sample. Now, coming to the mastitis management from field point of view. Now, when we divide, ask mastitis how it occurs, we divide the causative organism of the mastitis into two categories: environmental associated pathogens, cow associated pathogens. Environmental associated pathogens, E. coli, Streptococcus aureus, they are present in the manure, soil, bedding, feedstuff, water. Whereas these organisms, they are present on the teat, on the udder skin, on the milk equipment, in the milk. So they are transmitted during milking time. These organisms, they are transmitted during milking time. And these, when the animal after milking, it sits in the ground, it may pick up the infection from the environment in between milking. So contamination takes place for these in between milking, for these during milking. So for control of these organisms, we have need the cowshed hygiene. Shed should be properly hygiene, there should be proper drainage, etc. For this prevention of this mastitis, we should have milking hygiene. So both cowshed hygiene and milking hygiene is important. Now, coming to the diagnosis. Clinical, it is not a problem, but subclinical, we need. There are many tests, but I will be discussing here only from field point of view, which we can apply and which we can use. One is this strip cup test. So this is a simple cup with a black plate. We take 1 to 2 streaks at first milk from every teat in this cup so that milk goes down. And if there are any fine flocculations, we will be able to observe here. and we can say this particular teat is developing mastitis. And second, it has advantage. It is recommended that we do this drip cup test at every milk. One, it has the benefit that we will be able to diagnose the disease at early stage. Secondly, it will lower the bacterial count of the milk, because sometimes the bacterial count of these teat milk, early first milk, they are more in number. So when we will be not mixing the whole milk, so total bacterial count will go down. So it has two advantages. Now other tests are California mastitis test, then BTB car test, then electrical connectivity test, which is in the milk I will be discussing one by one. And other is the culture sensitivity test. Means we culture the milk, we find the bacteria and to which drug it is sensitive. Now, first is the BTB car test, bromothymol blue. This is called bromothymol blue car test. So this is a simple filter paper with a bromothymol blue. We have made four spots for left fore, left hind, right fore, right hind. And this is a 1.6% alcoholic solution of dye. And we keep it, make it and dry. And when we have test the milk sample, we put a one drop of milk from each quarter from on this paper spot. And we note for the change in color. If it remains yellow, it is normal. If it becomes a yellowish green, plus one. If it becomes green, plus two. If it becomes bluish, plus three. So this is based on the pH of the milk to the alkaline side. In mastitis, milk pH goes to the alkaline side. And please remember, it is not there that it will go more than seven. Because in subclinical cases, it may go from 6.7 to 6.8, 6.85, 6.9. So that is why it is not diagnosed with the normal pH paper. And we have a special BTB card paper. Like here, this is also, there is a one available from this Antas Pharma Memistrip. So these are similar. This we are producing in the laboratory and we are supplying to the farmers at low profit or to the technical persons. And this is available for the use by the Bhandarians throughout India also. Now, other is the California mastitis test. Or this is a kind of test where we call it also paddle test in our local language, or we are called it SLS, sodium lauryl sulfate test, because we are using sodium lauryl sulfate as a reagent in this test. So this is a kind of detergent. When we have to test the milk samples, we take 2 to 3 ml of milk sample from each quarter, left fore, left hind, right fore, right hind, and then mix equal quantity of reagent in these are the pores, and then give rotate in circular motion and see for the any gel formation. If it remains liquid, then there is no evidence of mastitis. If there is a smile precipitate underground, thin precipitate, it is plus one. If it is more thick gel like gum, then it is plus two. If there is a very thick gel, like we make a levy from wheat flour, we make a mixture of wheat flour and butter like wheat flour, and it becomes central peel, then it is a plus three. So this is again a very good test for use at the field level. This can be used with the reagent is taken. Then this is the electrical conductivity test. So this we have the portable electrical conductivity meter. We can measure the conductivity by the cow side. Otherwise, laboratory conductivity meters, they are also available. This is reflected. We take milk from left fore, then press measure left fore, left hind, right fore, right hind. It records the electrical conductivity for all the four quarters. And if any quarter is having electrical conductivity more than 15% than any other quarter, then it marks that quarter red. So in electrical conductivity, I tell you, we can use absolute conductivity or as a relative conductivity. Why absolute conductivity means we take, okay, in cattle, in crossbred cattle, this is, and this electrical conductivity is greatly affected by the fat percentage, then by proteins, by the stage of lactation. Now fat has an inhibitory effect on the electrical conductivity. So buffaloes, they will be having lower electrical conductivity. They may have up to 4 millisiemens. Then our local cattle will be having slightly more, but less than crossbred cattle. Now crossbred cattle may be having 5.5 millisiemens per centimeter electrical conductivity or up to 6, depending on the farm to farm. So either we should know what is the normal electrical conductivity range at a farm, and then we can define that limit. So okay, for this farm, this limit is 5.5. So any quarter having more than then, it is considered normal. Or otherwise, what is the best? We use relative conductivity. We measure conductivity for all the four quarters. Now, if suppose left four quarter is having a conductivity of 5, then other is having 5.2, third is having 5.3. So this variation may be there. But if it is more than 15%, suppose sixth quarter is having 5.8 or 6, so this is more than 15% of the quarter having less than 5. So then definitely that pattern is having a some disease, some mastitis. So this is used relative to each quarter, to each quarter. So we can use this in this way. Now, other is the culture sensitivity testing. But in I will like to share with my fellow colleagues. So this is sampling in this is very important, because many times we are receiving in the laboratory, farmer is coming with the samples and sample is not properly taken and it is not giving any result. So first thing you have to ensure that whenever you go sent for sampling for culture sensitivity, animal should have not been administered with antibiotic, neither parenteral nor intramembrane for 3 to 5 days, last 3 to 5 days. So otherwise antibiotic will come into the milk and it will not allow the bacteria to grow. So this is the first thing. Second, we have to take the milk samples from all the four quarters separately, not a udder milk is not to be sent. Third, udder should be clean and dry, proper clean and dry. If it is already animal is clean and dry, then there is no need of wetting it. There is no need of washing it. Now, if it is having some dung sticking to it or some other debris, and if there is a need to wash, then we may wash it with. And after washing, completely dry your hands, completely dry the teeth, completely dry the udder. Because otherwise, if a small drop of water came into milk, then it will be a big contamination and it will mask the exact actual organisms. So we have to ensure that it is completely clean and dry. Then we have to clean the tip of the teat with the spirit swab or with the thiol alcohol or with some other antiseptic. First, we have to clean the opposite side. So we are sitting on the left side, we have to clean the right fore teeth, then right hind, and then left fore and left hind. And when we start collecting milk sample, it has to be collected from the upper side, from the nearer side, left fore, left hind. This is a simple principle, because when we disinfectant or when we antiseptic put on the left fore teeth and then we will try to disinfect right fore, then we may touch the teeth second time. That is why other side teeth, they are cleaned first. And similarly, when we try to collect the milk sample from opposite side first, then we may contaminate the teeth. So milk sample cleaning opposite side first, collection upper side first. So in this way, and tube should be kept at an angle of 45 degrees. Otherwise, we have to avoid directly some falling of some debris into the tube. Then we should immediately close the tube, and it can be kept in the lower compartment of the refrigerator. Don't freeze the samples. Don't freeze the samples. If we have to shift within 1 to 2 hours, 3 hours, then it is not a problem. Otherwise, we can transfer it to the laboratory in the ice, so as to maintain the bacterial quality of the milk, so that bacteria may not grow unnecessarily. So this is how we have to take the milk samples. Now, after diagnosis of the subclinical mastitis, then comes the question whether we should treat subclinical mastitis and how to manage it. So recommendation is that whenever this CMT score of more than 2, we can go for the treatment. And but we have to judge whether the animal is in the early stage of the lactation. If it is in the early stage of the lactation in 1, 2, 3 months, definitely, because this is going to loss of the milk is going to happen throughout the lactation, and it may be a source of infection to the other quarters for a long time. So we may go for the treatment. But if it is in the late stage of the lactation, so it is at 6 months or 7 months, then we may wait for the dry therapy. So then we may not, because of drug residues or because of this less cure, because during lactation cure rates are less due to the more milk. So then we may wait for a dry therapy. Or alternately, we may use streptococcus, that we every day we test the milk samples for streptococcus, and if we find any evidence of developing clinical mastitis, then we immediately we should treat. Now, how to treat this subclinical mastitis? So in this, we have seen, we have done several studies. In this intramammary antibiotic, in a particular quarter, it is sufficient. We can treat with the intramammary antibiotic preparations depending on the sensitivity. Or otherwise, even mild cases, they may be treated with some supportive therapy. We have tried some herbal therapies also with some tulsi, ashwagandha. They are also working in the specific subclinical mastitis they are treating. Similarly, vitamins and minerals, they have a very good role in the immunity of the animal, in the udder health of the root. Vitamin A, it maintains the functional epithelium, beta carotene, it is immunomodulator. Vitamin E again, antioxidant, similarly, copper and zinc, immunomodulation. So similarly, restoration of the milk pH by using ammonium chloride at 13 gram daily, we can give for 7 days, or trisodium citrate it can be given at 30 milligram per kilogram body weight. So they bring the milk pH to the normal side, and they help in the treatment of the mild cases of the mastitis. So all these vitamins and minerals and this sodium citrate, this one commercial preparation is available. This can be used, or otherwise you can use different antibiotics mineral mixers also. So by this, we will be limiting the other damage. And we have seen that this restores the yield and quality also in terms of electrical connectivity, in terms of cell count, in terms of fat percentage, in terms of protein. So in clinical, once the case becomes clinical, there is a less recovery. So it is recommended that we may treat subclinical mastitis, and we can go for testing of cell count for 21 to 28 days after. So please note that when we are doing CMT test, cell count will not immediately come down. It will take at least 3 to 4 weeks to come down. So sometimes veterinarian, they are coming to us that we have treated the case, but cell count is coming again, because it after healing of the epithelium, cell count will go slowly and slowly down. Now, then another case, parkute cases, which is totally different treatment, and veterinarians, they should know that this is a very important how to treat parkute mastitis, which is occurring suddenly. So one thing is that we should start treatment immediately within 4 to 6 hours. If we are going to treat the case within 4 to 6 hours, we will be able to save the quarter, or we will be able to save the animal. Otherwise, animal may be lost, or even if we save the animal, quarter will definitely lost if we delay the treatment by more than 6 hours. So whenever you receive the information from the farmer that so and so happened, it happened suddenly, farmer also notes it suddenly, then advise him or her to frequently strip out the milk at 1 to 2 hours, every hour, so that we are releasing the endotoxin. So this is a toxemia. This is a kind of endotoxin. This is not the bacteria. This occurs due to the toxins, E. coli toxins, just toxins. So even oxytocin can be used to frequent milking. So through a day, we do this frequent milking and ask the farmer to do immediately cold water application. They can be fired on the udder just to subside the inflammation. That should be done. Then we should start with the parental antibiotics. And this supplementary of intramammary antibiotic can be done only after 12 hours or after 24 hours after leave of the endotoxins, after frequent milking. Parental antibiotics, and we have seen that we can use combination of antibiotics in this. There may be many combinations, like in particularly E. coli mastitis, this enrofloxacin can be used along with this amoxicillin, amoxicillin and this surfactant combination. It can be, hello? Is it okay, please?
Yes, it's all okay.
Okay, it's a parental antibiotic. So we can use, in particularly in these cases, we can use enrofloxacin along with the amoxicillin and sulbactam combination. They are also giving very good results. Then gentamicin can also be used. Then along with the antibiotic, we need management. Even if we will give a single antibiotic, we will not be able to treat the case. We have to use the normal saline, and it can be used at 100 ml per kilogram body weight. Means we need 30 to 40 liter of normal saline, 10 to 20 liter of
Bansal sir?
हाँ जी
वीडियो लोगों का सर वीडियो डिस्कनेक्ट हो गया एक दो मिनट रुकिए ना सर
अच्छा जी
सर एक ही मिनट में रिजॉल्व कर रहा हूँ
आमन आजा तो
वीडियो डिलीट कर दे
प्रशांत
सर एक ही सेकंड हो रहा है
ओके
हेलो
दोबारा क्या ट्राई करिए
सर यू आर लाइव नाउ गुड टू गो सर
ओके सो ओके आई स्टार्ट थैंक यू सो वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द Percute mastitis. I told you frequent stripping, and then I will start it again. So in percute mastitis, whenever you receive a call from the farmer or any information, first thing is we have to recommend the farmer to go for immediately stripping of the milk at every 1 to 2 hours. Even oxytocin may be used so that it is we are leaving the toxins which are found in the gland. It is not the bacteria; it is the toxins which is leading to the. It is a kind of endotoxemic shock. So we have to do frequent milking. Then we have to use the parental antibiotic immediately. We have to recommend, and mainly parental antibiotics. We in such cases, which is a gram negative bacteria, we may go for the enrofloxacin in combination with some amoxicillin combinations or with some other antibiotics also, whatsoever they are effective. And then we have to do intramammary supplementation only at the end of day or the next day. Then. Only antibiotic is not sufficient. We have to do intensive therapy. It needs definitely normal saline, fluid therapy, up to 30 to 40 liters and 10 to 20 liters in first 1 to 2 hours. Then we have to use 50% dextrose, 500 ml for Nurgi, then 5% sodium bicarbonate, 3 to 4 liters. Then non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. They are very important for to check the inflammation, to control the inflammation to the pain. We can use. Is it okay? हेलो
नीचे देख ले हमसे नीचे देख ले
इज इट ओके प्लीज हेलो
हां सर
इज इट ओके प्लीज शुड आई कंटिन्यू हेलो शुड आई कंटिन्यू प्लीज
यस यस सर
प्लीज प्लीज ऑल ओके ना
Yeah,
yes, sir. Okay.
Continue, sir.
Okay.
Okay. Then we can use this non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like meloxicam, 0.5 milligram per body weight, intravenous or intramuscular. Then flunixin, meglumine, phenylbutazone. Then calcium borogluconate because here calcium is decreased very much, but it should be administered with care, and it is safer following the fluid therapy, and it should be given slow, very slow. Then multivitamins to support antihistamines. Then topically we can give some anti-inflammatory ointments. It may be some herbal ointment. It may be from the tropical other available ointments from. We can go for this, and we have to do this intensive therapy. Only then we will be able to save the animal and save the quarter. Otherwise, what will happen? It will be red, hot, painful. If we are not treating, then it will become bluish, cold, then discoloration, and ultimately it will slough down. So when it becomes blue and coldness and it is going to slough, then there is no treatment. It will be going to be sloughed, and we are losing the quarter. Now then comes for the therapy of the acute mastitis. So for the acute mastitis, there are 3-4 principles which we should follow. Although it is a antibiotics and it is a supportive therapy we have to use for this treatment of mastitis, but first important thing is choice of drug. Which drug you have to use? So this depends upon the sensitivity of the farm or specific area specific data. So if you should know which drug is effective in your area. If you know the culture sensitivity pattern, it is okay. If you don't know, then you must be having some experience that this antibiotic is acting good. So and this activating antibiotic you are getting good response. So you may use that, or you may go for the culture sensitivity testing of samples for few cases and then find the best drug possible in vitro. Then adequate dose and route, it is very important. Dosing interval, duration, minimum duration, it should be 5 days, 3 to 5 days. Because this dose and route, many times I have seen there veterinarian, one time when we are called by the farmer, we give one injection, and then come back and then do not follow. Next day we go to the second case and we not advise and follow. So treating for one day or two, we leave the treatment in between by this case is not cured. So dosing interval, dose route, preferably route, we should go for the earlier administrations by the wherever possible by intravenous administration so as to leave the drug in proper concentration. Then we have to find the experience that combination therapy, although it may work intramemory or parental in some cases, but when we use combination intramemory plus parental, this gives the better cure rates. Then we need supportive therapy. When we give the supportive therapy to the cure cases like calcium borogluconate, we can give 200-250 ml first day, 250 ml second day, intravenous, along with some galactagogues, then mineral supplementation, injections, vitamin B complex, injections, multivitamins. Then it helps in the restoration of the milk and it helps in the early recovery. So as a package, antibiotics, multivitamins, galactagogues, minerals, calcium, when we use this, this will give the good response, good result, good therapy. And following treatment, definitely we should recommend that milk should be withheld for 3 to 4 days because of the drug residues. Otherwise, it has severe implications for the consumer health as well as for the calf health. So this should be followed. Now, why this sensitivity is important? You see, we have the data with our laboratory from 1984 to 2016, even today. This graph is up to 2016. So we find that ampicillin, cloxacillin, which were effective more than 60% in 1984, they came down to less than 20%. Again, they start gaining this sensitivity. Similarly, gentamicin, it remains almost at the same. Then this black one, this tetracycline, its sensitivity again increasing from the lower to the upper side. So drug sensitivity goes on changing. And we have also seen that within farms, it varies from farm to farm. We have the data. In one geographical area, it is same. In other geographical area, it is different. And it varies from the farm to pharma also. So culture sensitivity is very, very important. Then this is the current drug sensitivity pattern, which we are observing. We find that this combination drug, like this ceftriaxone, thiobevectin, they are very highly effective than ceftriaxone. It is highly effective. Amoxicillin, this is very, very, amoxicillin alone does not affect much. But amoxicillin, selvectum combination is good. Enrofloxacin is very giving good results. Gentamicin giving good results. Other they are ceftriaxone, neomycin, they are also in the upper range. And other this teramycin. But these streptomycin, moxicillin, cloxacillin, penicillin, they are having some to the lesser extent. In vitro, they are less effective. So this is the drug sensitivity pattern of the Punjab state, which we are receiving. We are receiving thousands of samples to the laboratory. And on this basis, this is the drug sensitivity pattern. Now, I told you this combination therapy is important. You can see from this slide. This is just for example. When we use a duration of therapy is important. When we treat for 5 days, we get a poor cure rate. So whenever we get respond, we should treat the case antibiotic for 5 days. Then anatomical location of the pathogen is important. Which pathogen is causing the disease? Whether it is a staphylococci, whether it is a streptococcus, whether it is a E. coli. So primarily we have three organisms. Primarily, we have a streptococci only and E. coli only, acute mastitis. And few mild cases may be caused by the streptococci or cryoneuroctium. So then these Staphylococcus aureus, it is present an intracellular organism. It is a deep cellular, intracellular organism. So for treatment of these cases, we need definitely a parental therapy. And we should also use the intramammary therapy moderately. So to treat Staphylococcus, please use combination therapy, parental plus intramammary, then you will get good response. You will get good recovery. Now, Staphylococcus, this is present in the T ducts, cryoneuroctium, environmental bacteria, they're present in that. So we can get good results with the intramammary therapy alone. So here maybe we may avoid the parental therapy. When it is a mild cases, then we can go for this. Now, this per-acute cases, systemic reaction, it is a systemic infection and we will get good results only parental. So we have to use the combination of antibiotics here, parentally, intravenous, intramuscular, and here intramammary therapy may not work. Although we may add it up to 24 hour or 36 hour to be supplemented, otherwise parental therapy will work into the good extent. So these are some of the examples that combination therapy gives better cure rates. Now then, number of previous treatments are important. This is a one case study. Although you may get more than 46% response, it is not that it is always cure rate is so less. It may be 60 to 70%. We are also getting cure rates for 60. So my idea to show is that when the case is presented to you first time, you have the more chances to treat the case. And when it is second time, third time, and fourth time, their chances going down. So immediately case presentation and proper treatment is very important. Then drugs, which are considered to be having good distribution to the memory gland by parental and by intramembrane distribution. This enrofloxacin, rithromycin, trimethoxim, oxytetracycline, they have a good distribution. Ampicillin, moxicillin, they have a limited distribution. Gentamicin, streptomycin, they have a poor distribution. So here, these drugs, they have been shown to poor distribution, but I will say that these, although they have poor distribution, but these drugs, they gentamicin, they go to the intracellular and they can be used for the treatment of staphylococcal mastitis, but we have to maintain the dose, proper dosing in normal, then they work well in spite of their poor distribution. So these are the some of the clinical combinations we may use, like enrofloxacin, we may use 7.5 milligram per subcut intramuscular SID, or initially we may do use two times, and then we recommend once a day, or long acting, we can repeat every third day. Then amoxicillin, even 4.5 gram intravenous to adult animal, even loading dose, it may be more than 4.5 gram, it may be 8 gram, it may be 9 gram, and then we go for that. Similarly, if we have to combine intramemory, we can any preparation of ampicillin, cloxacillin, or amoxicillin, sodium, they can be combined. Then this cefepirazone, it can be a 10 milligram per kilogram body weight intra, it may be repeated BID, it may be, and this intramemory, we can give this 250 milligram along with this, and it can be repeated on third day. Cipquinone, we can go up to 2 milligram per kilogram intravenous, and it can be repeated depending, because antibiotic, they can be depending on the severity and intensity, it can be repeated. And we can go for the intramemory 75 milligram. There are these combinations, intramemory preparations, they are available for this. So gentamicin, again, very good drug. This can be used at intravenous 3 to 5 milligram, but we have to repeat it in morning and evening, and preferably we have to give intravenous. So we can use this gentamicin, or we can give neomycin. Intramemory preparations are available. We can go for that combination, and we will get good result in all these. I expect that in all these we will get good results. Similarly, if we have to use ampicillin, moxicillin, dose is very high, 20 milligram, then followed by 10 milligram, and we can use combination. Similarly, sulfa, trimethoxazine, erythromycin, tylosin, 10 milligram, ceftiofur. So these can be used. My idea is we have to use combination therapy, and it had to be used in proper dose and proper dosing interval, then definitely you will get good result even for any antibiotic. So for intramemory infusion, just I want to share, although you are very learned and you know better. So it should be whenever we have to use the intramemory therapy, because sometimes we ask the farmer, you do it, we take it very casual. So when we have to do right way of taking intramemory therapy is very important. We have to completely evacuate the quarter. Order it completely, milk evacuation is very important. Then it should be clean and dry. Tip of the teat should be cleaned with spit swab. And cannula of the tube should not be touched. It should not be inserted fully to the teat. It should be, can be kept at the tip of the teat, and then press from down piston. And when the drug goes inside, with one hand we can hold the tip of the teat, and with the other hand massage the teat to the upwards. So this will lead to the distribution of the drug to the udder and to the gland. So this proper use of intramemory therapy is very important to avoid any contamination. Then comes the chronic quarters, when there is a formation of fibrillary cord. So when it is a dry fibrillary cord, then we may left as such. Because whenever I have seen many times, we receive many inquiries that there is a fibrillary cord, whether it can be treated or with. So practically we have found that it is not rewarding. Even if you go for surgery, then it is a so delicate tissue, then it will be closed. So fibrillary cord, once it is formed, it is not. Although some people, they are recommending this homeopathy drugs, they are being recommended for like this calcarea or for the cilicia, they are recommending, and their in literature available, it is acting to 40% to 30% or 50%. But in my experience, almost nothing works when it is a complete fibrillary cord, or when it is a small nodule or some fibrillary cord at the tip of the teat, then we may use a teat plug. we may use the teat plug. We may continuously 48 hours, 72 hours. Teat plug can be installed in the tip of the teat, and then it can be kept. We can use the teat dipping, and same time at the same time we can use antibiotic also intramammary. And many times we have seen that this nodule itself, it goes to the side and the passage is formed for the milking. Now, if we go for some cut or if we try to remove this power, this nodule, then again we may be doing injury, and there are many chances that teat will be totally closed. Similarly, so this surgery, teat surgery, is not rewarding practically. So it should not be, we may not be treated. Whether we are able to manage with some these methods, then it is okay. Otherwise, no surgery. Now, then when it is a chronic case, three times treat more than one rotation, again it is going to affect. But in our case, we are not losing that water, we are not culling the animal. So we can go treat, we can try treatment of such cases with a dry therapy. Because many times we have seen that a quarter is not producing less or having some all dryness, some infection during the grunt lactation. When we treat with the dry therapy in the lactant lactation, it regains the synthetic tissue, this milk tissue is again formed, and the milk yield is restored in the next time. So one hope is dry therapy for such cases. Then when thick bacilli buttery discharge is coming and it is not responding to therapy, because such cases, they remain source of infection for the others. So such cases, they can be dried. Chemically, they can be dried out. We can dry it with copper sulfate, 5%, 20 ml intramammary. Please remember, not more than 5%. Sometimes we ask the farmer, you take it and then dissolve it and then give intramammary, not like that. It may spoil the whole order. It may be only 5% copper, 20 ml intramammary infusion. It will result into chemical drying of water and step out. If it is not done in one case, we can repeat it after 40 days. So this can be done for the chronic chemical dry of food. So this is from a theoretical point of view. We are in the developed countries, means when the cows have more size cell count of more than 5 lakh or they have low yield cow, these cows practically they should be culled. Now, coming to the control of mastitis. Now, this I talked about the treatment and management, but scientifically recommendation, control of the disease is very important than the treatment. And mastitis control program, it is not a single point agenda, it is a multiple component program, because there is a source of animal picks of the infection. So any bacteria, if we will eliminate the source of infection, we will not get the case. So minimizing the source of infection is very important, and this can be achieved by the hygiene. Then eliminating of the existing infection, we know that we have subclinical infections. So that can be eliminated, and that can be best eliminated by the dry therapy. What is this dry therapy? I will tell you later on. Then animal may pick up the infection during milking or in between milking during the environment. So then we have to prevent that the animal does not pick up the infection through the teat canal. So this can be prevented by teat dipping. Then this bovine mastitis is an example of disease where there is a fight between the infection and the body mechanism, immunity or the other immunity. So when the animal is having higher resistance to the occurrence, then it can eliminate the infection. So this we can enhance the non-specific immunity. Non-specific immunity means it is not a directed against a particle. It is a generalized. It is a ability of the phagocytic cells to kill the bacteria, any other infectious agent. So non-specific immunity can be enhanced. There are two, three components of how we can enhance the non-specific immunity. Then specific immunity is against particular organism, like for HS. So specific immunity, we have to make the vaccine for particular organism, for like E. coli, for Staphylococcus aureus. Then genetic improvement, udder defense. Udder should be more resistant, more than this can be done by the genetic improvement. Now coming by one by one, hygiene. So we have to minimize the source of infection. Milking and environmental hygiene is very important. We have to keep the dryness under the animal. As far as possible, then we will be able to manage maximum number of cases of the mastitis. Then clinical cases, they should be segregated and proper treatment should be done. Then lactation therapy of subclinical mastitis should be done. Very chronic cases, then culling can be done. And then there should be proper disposal of dung and urine that should be there. And we have seen that 40% of the cases, clinical cases, at the farm, they are counted by the 7% of these cow. They are getting again and again mastitis. Similarly, 50% of the discarded milk comes from the 6% of the cows. And a cow which has two episodes of the mastitis, 64% of the cow that had two episodes of the mastitis will have another before the end of the lactation. So this study we have done at our farm. We have a very good number of animals, and we have studied for 3-4 years, 10 years, 12 years data. We have managed, and we have seen that a cow which are getting 2 episodes, right? There are 60-70% chances that it will be getting third time. So such a small number of animals, they are contributing for the loss of the whole herd. So such animals, they can be eliminated, can be culled. So hygiene is very important. Sometimes you do not need any antibiotic. Now I will like to share with you one example. So we have been called by a farmer at a farm that he is getting a daily per cure cases of mastitis, that immediately he is getting. So when we went to the farm, what he was doing, he was milking the animal and then immediately leaving that animal to the water tank. He had made some water tank for the cooling of the animal. Animal was milked and it was just then left to the water tank animal. So in water tank, every day water is not replaced. Animal doing dung, animal passing urine. So that was a source of coli for bacteria. So when the animal is going, immediately after milking, teat orifice is opened, animal going to that and getting case, per acute case. So simply by advising him management that this is a wrong practice, we were able to control the mastitis. No antibiotic, no other therapy. So this is the case. Similarly, when from management point of view, at other farm we went, they were having very high level of good level of cows, which were giving high yield, and high yielding cow, they are more prone to summer, they are making more heat. So they were continuously putting these sprayers, water sprayers, and always the animal is remaining wet and underground remaining wet. Then again, cases of acute mastitis, there are more cases. So we recommend that from health point of view, that although cooling is needed, and then animal be taken frequently to the cooling showers and then brought again to the dry place so as to prevent the mastitis. So my idea is to share that sometimes simply by managing hygiene, by environment, we can control the disease. We may not need always. So we have to be open and we have to discuss each and everything, how it happens. Now, then is the dry cow therapy. What is this dry cow therapy? Now, this is I told you there are some in clinical, subclinical infections existing also. Dry therapy means dry period. Dry period means when the animal becomes pregnant, and it is recommended that we should at least and dry the cow or the buffalo at least 2 months before the next expected date of calving. Now in crossbred cows, it is happening that they are giving the milk even up to the end of the pregnancy, but it is never recommended. We will have never complete milk next lactation, and we will have more intramammary infections or more intramammary mastitis cases in next lactation. So always dry the animal at least 2 months before the next expected date of calving. And it has been seen that during dry period, immunity of the animal is compromised. Although there are more neutrophils, more phagocytic cells, but due to their secretion changes, due to the colostrum or due to the other factors, these immune cells, they are not able to function properly. And most of the 48% of the cow infections during dry period. And half of these infections, they persist into the next lactation. And they develop into the clinical mastitis in the post-calving period, into the first 2-3 months. So we have primary objective of the dry therapy is under health management is to have minimum infected quarters at next calving. And this can be achieved by dry therapy. Now you find that as I told you, animal is in the immunosuppression around dry period, around calving. That is why we are getting more metritis, endometritis, hypomagal displacement, or some other cases, infection, periparturient disorders. Animal is in the immunosuppression. So this is the highest risk period. First three weeks of dry period, because here intramammary pressure is there, teat orifice is open, and there is a flushing of the milk is stopped. We start flushing, and because flushing is stopped, then infection is not eliminated. And many times now we are receiving the information, we are receiving the from the farmers. They say that when they have left the animal, it was very good. It was giving complete milking. We have dried a healthy udder, but at the next calving, it has become like a stone. It has become hard. It has become atrophied. It is like a brick. No milk is coming. So reason is when we were flushing, infection was, bacteria were eliminating, but when we stopped milking, then there were bacteria inside, they start flourishing, and they did not allow the differentiation of the tissue, alveolar tissue, and they all is fibrosed. And next time, at next calving, we got only hard, fibrosed udder, no milk. So this is the many times we are getting cases in this case. So this is again, then this is a there is a low risk of mastitis because keratin plaque is found here. No keratin plaque, keratin plaque is found. And again, in the last weeks of the pregnancy, again colostomy there, intramammary pressure increases, immunity is suppressed. So again, there are more chances of getting infection here. So this can be best managed by dry therapy. What is dry therapy? This is a long acting antibiotic. Like cloxacillin, normally sodium, we are using lactating. Benzathine cloxacillin, it is a long acting. Similarly, for several antibiotics, long acting preparations, they are coming and they are effective for 6 to 8 weeks. So what we have to do at the end of last milking, after complete clean dry udder, after dipping, we have to give one intramembrane infusion into each quarter. And then thereafter, we have not to evacuate it. We have to use de-dipping for 10 to 14 days and we have to left it such. What will do, it will eliminate the any existing intramembrane infection. It will prevent the new intramembrane infections, chances which are 6 times more. And it will also help in the differentiation cell development, utter glandular tissue, very good differentiation. And it will result into the increase in the milk yield by 8 to 10%. So this study we have done at our farm by using dry therapy preparations, and we have compared that cell count is lowered in the next calving, milk quality is improved, milk yield is significantly improved, and the number of infections are eliminated, and their existing infections are eliminated, significant prevention of new infections. Even in the post-calving period, we get protection up to 3 months. You can see here from that. Now, at 3 months, if we in the treated quarters, we get only 50%, 70% cases. In untreated quarters, up to 13% cases. Similarly, so it could protect significantly in the post-calving period up to 3 months. So this dry therapy is a very good alternative. It is a very good control measure under Indian dairy conditions. Now, other is teat sealants. They are also coming, teat sealants, because this is a simply physical barrier to the infections. Because 50% of the teats, they close by 7 days, and 50% do not close up to 52 second days. So they remain the source of the infection. So we can use physical barrier, teat silence like ethyl alcohol, 53% coming. It is applied as a teat dip at a dry off and 7 to 14 days. But this is effective for 3 to 4 days only. So this can be used in combination with dry therapy. Now other internal teat sealant like 65% bisphosphonate subnitrate. So this can be, but this can be used only infection free quarters. Otherwise, if there is a cartridge infected and we give this bisphosphonate subnitrate, then infection is there inside. So when we have to use the dry therapy only. So in infection-free quarters, we can use it and then it can be effective. But I will recommend dry therapy in our case. So then tea dipping. So this is the done after every milking, because this tea dip will form a layer of medicine or chemical at the tea tip. Any bacteria coming in contact will be killed, and it normally in 2 to 3 hours teat orifice is closed. So this post milking tea dipping is recommended, and we can use, and also as a management farm, it is recommended that after post milking, animal should be offered some concentrate or powder in the post milking period also, so that animal remains standing and it may or not pick up the infection from the environment. So best is the iodine preparation, 0.5% plus glycerin, we have to add up to 12%. Because it will act as an emollient. Otherwise, in winter, it will be a dryness of teeth. So 10 to 12% iodine is added. If we will add more, then it will decrease the antiseptic property. If we will less, then it will lead to the dryness of the teeth. So this kind of teeth dip is very good for prevention of intramammary infection and also for any injury, chaps, any to the teeth. Even in the winter, you will find, we find that some cracks develop on the teats, and veterinarians, they are coming to us and they are giving some injections, some streptomycin, some other antibiotics. There is no need of such cases. We can simply treat by dipping the teats in iodine glycerin tea dip. Otherwise, the chlorhex, this can also be used, chlorhexidine tea dip. So then activated lactic acid, natural, no problem. These are the also available. So we have to dip the teats, all teats, morning and evening continuously. So this will reduce the chance of the intramammary infection and prevent the occurrence of the disease. So nowadays, two types of tea dips are recommended, pre-milking tea dipping, post-milking tea. Now, cow-associated pathogens, Staph aureus, I told you, their contamination takes place during milking. And invasion takes place, suppose we have contaminated the quarter at milking, so invasion will be taken immediately after milking. So we have to do post-dipping. Similarly, environmental and invasion takes place during milking. Contamination takes place in between milking, contaminate, okay, when the teat is contaminated, And when at milking, we will be doing milking, teat orifice will be opened, and there are chances that infection take place at the time of milking. So here pre-dipping is recommended. So for complete control, post-dipping and pre-dipping is recommended. So you can see the health of the teat. This is a dipped teat in iodine glycerin. This is a undipped teat. Then practically, now in market, sprays are available, teat dips are available, but the spray usually, we are not able to achieve uniform distribution and there is a higher consumption. So from economic point of view, from scientific point of view, we recommend we should use the cup dipping, teat dipping using the cups, that is the more advantage. Then I talked of the non-specific immunity and specific immunity. So non-specific immunity, it can be enhanced by 2-3 factors. Now this is under search area, these cytokines, interferons, interleukins, colony stimulating factors, they are there. Then nutritional approach, vitamin A, beta carotene, copper, zinc, vitamin, selenium. Then specific immunity by vaccine, genetic improvement. Now these cytokines, they are group of proteins, immune cells, which enhance the cellular immune function. All these interferons, interleukins. So they can be used along with the treatment in clinical cases or in the prevention of the disease. As a non-specific immunomodulator in mild cases, they can be used. But this is under trial and under research. Practically, this sterility not in field cases, not followed. Then nutrition, which can be taken in the field. This is very important. Around calving, animal is in the compromised state of immunity, and even slightest nutritional deficiency, it has a detrimental effect on the function of immune system. Now this, when we give vitamin A, it maintains the functional alveolar epithelium and it provides a physical barrier to the entrance of pathogens. Similarly, beta carotene enhances the immune function. Zinc strengthens the skin epithelium of the teat canal. Copper protects the host tissue from membrane oxidation. Vitamin E and selenium act as antioxidants. So all these minerals, vitamins, they enhance the immunity of the animal and prevent the occurrence of the disease. So this supplementation of these minerals and vitamins is very important for the prevention of the disease. And we should continue. Sometimes nutrition people, they say that when the animal is not lactating, we may not be leading, or we may be needing less mineral mixture, or we may not be leading. But it is recommended that it should be given through whole dry period and around calving also. Vitamin A, it can be given up to 53,000 international, beta carotene 300 milligram daily, zinc, this 180 to 360 milligram. And medium methionine, copper, 20 parts per million, vitamin E, selenium. So they should be used and recommended for the prevention of the disease. Then vaccination, they are all under trials. Leukocytes, after the invasion take place, after the bacteria are not killed by the external cellular mechanism, then leukocytes, they are the second line of defense that need the, and they need the help of antibodies to promote killing of bacteria, to promote killing of particular bacteria. So antibodies, they are important resistant mechanism as they are specifically directed against a pathogen. Concentration of antibodies can be increased by vaccination only. And they can activate in many ways. They can coat the bacteria and help in opsonization. They can prevent the adherence of the bacteria or tissue so that they may not result into pathogenesis. They can cause the direct lysis of the myelin. There are many ways, many mechanisms by which these antibodies, they act. So people have tried this Staph aureus vaccine for protein A component, for pseudocapsid, but no vaccine is effective, single vaccine is effective in prevention of the occurrence of the disease. Although it may lower the symptoms of the disease, it may eliminate the subclinical infections, but it lowers the milk medicine count, but no vaccine is effective that we give like we give in a HS or like we give in a FEV, that we have given the vaccine and it has prevented the occurrence. No, because there is a permanent source of infection at the farm. There are many strains of the farm. There is a continued source. Milk is a continued source of the. So no single vaccine is effective. Then other vaccine, coli farm vaccine is also available. So this is given one injection at dry off, then at 30 days and within 40 days. And people have, scientists have told that it significantly prevents the occurrence of the coli farm cases of mastitis in the post-calving period. So they are under trial. So vaccine alone cannot be used. It can be used as a part of the mastitis control program. Then the genetic improvement, it is important. Now this genetic, we have seen that this milk yield and cell count, it has a correlation of 0.24. So selection of milk yield for animal result into 0.3 to 0.9% increase in the occurrence of the mastitis per year. And there is a high genetic correlation between somatic cell count and subclinical mastitis 0.25, and between the somatic cell score and clinical mastitis 0.8. So when we are selecting the animal for lower somatic cell count, then we will be having lower cases of the mastitis. And when we are selecting the animal, breeding the animal for higher milk yield, then we will be having more cases of the mastitis. So ideally, it should be somatic cell score should be included into the breeding program that of the sire and of the dam, and where we should go. And we should wait a selection indexes, and then each trait according to their value, we should go for the genetic improvement. So this is the one slide. I want to give to you the idea. This is from my professor Hamann. When I visited Germany, they have studied this in the German cows, and they have found that after 6,000 liters of lactation per cow, their defense capacity goes down and culling rate of the animal goes down. So they say ideally animal is economical to rear at 6,000 to 7,000 of liters lactation levels, means daily yield, maximum yield 25 to 30 liter or 30 to 35 liter. And beyond that, we need more culling, and it may not be economical. So this was the main chapter I cleared with about the control of mastitis. Just passing reference, because we are seeing, we in Punjab, we are totally the milking has been replaced by milking machine, and we are seeing inquiries about this hyperkeratosis and all that from the veterinarian, from the farmers. So I just want to share in 2-3 slides this. So this milking machine, when we are not using properly, it becomes the source of infection and becomes the source of hyperkeratosis. Now when you are doing over milking or when increase machine on time, then it causes the redness of the teeth and hyperkeratosis. Now over milking, when high milking vacuum, inadequate pulse, when proper, then is not, then it pull out the keratin and prolonged time for teeth to seal after milking. So this keratin, when this pull on the keratin, then teeth orifice remains open, and there are more chances of the intramammary infections. So we have seen that when there is a more keratin, hyperkeratosis, rough to open teeth, there are more chances of the getting intramammary infections as compared to the healthy or normal teeth. This is a significant difference. So other factors, when we are not using properly machine milking, we can have a ringing at the base. When this cup of the milking machine is not properly, when it is a loose, then it is going down and up. Then similarly, reddish color, reddish blue, and we can have a blue ring. So this is the few, just in brief, I want to share with you this milking. When fault, milking machine function should be normal. Its milking vacuum, pressure, cleanliness, replacement of the liners, it should be normal. Otherwise, it may lead to the affect the health of the teeth and the also lead to the more mastitis cases. So to conclude, I will tell you, we have to use strip cup at every milking. Then this diagnosis indirect every 1 to 2 months. Then immediate therapy of subclinical cases. We have to eliminate dry of chronic cases. Then we have to go for hygiene measures. I told you, teeth dipping, dry therapy, immunity boosters, proper nutrition. And if we all do, we get a return on investment of 200% to 300%. So mastitis control, it looks that mastitis control, or if we are giving preventive some mineral mixtures or vitamins or some other therapy, that it will, it is costly. But it gives the returns to the investments. So mastitis control does not cost, it pays. So with these, I am thankful to you for this patience hearing and for your participation. And again, particularly I'm thankful to Das Animal Health, who has provided me this platform to interact with or to share my knowledge with the veterinarians throughout the country. Because this is a single parameter, although we are getting a veterinarian in small numbers from this state or adjacent states, but this is a very good opportunity for me to be with you. Thank you. Thank you once again.
Sir, really thank you for being a part of and taking the whole session along. I first and foremost, I'm sorry for the technical error that we had for a period of 8 to 9 minutes. It, when the screen went blank fully, so we are sorry for that. In case anyone has missed anything, just after the session ends, you can again be there for 2 minutes. The recorded version will be there, which you can watch, so that all your errors are nullified. You can listen to what you had missed on. So we have made that portion available for you. It was a technical error from our end. So please bear with the same. We thank you all for being there. Sir, we have a number of questions there for you, because mastitis is itself a very toxic subject.
Yeah.
So I'll take few of them. Okay. Let me once again say that whatever questions came up to us till yesterday night, Dr. Bansal has tried to attend on to all of them during the presentation, and I thank him for all these efforts. So that's brief about these questions. So I take up these questions one by one. The first question is from Dr. Tapas Kundu. He says, is there any use of using boric acid powder or alum when there is a bloody milk as a part of mastitis?
Yeah, normally in when there is a bloody milk, we call it as galactorrhagia. So one thing I will tell you, this is a infection free. In this, we do not find normally any bacteria. So here we are using galactorrhagia, we are using with formalin is recommended. We recommend calcium therapy along with this vitamin K. And then formalin, formaldehyde, 20 to 25 ml mixed in water, 250 ml to 300 ml water of this can be given orally, and then it can be repeated after 3 to 4 days. But please remember, it should be mixed in water. And then calcium, and then we are vitamin K, and we are getting good response for these. But boric acid, we have never used boric acid.
So the next question says, and it's a question from many people. I'll just put it before you. It's Dr. Srinivas and many others who wants to say how to manage telitis.
Telitis is we have studied particularly this telitis. We have this telitis many times. There are try to share with you that many times for acute mastitis cases or some this people are saying that telitis to that also. But telitis is actually a hard swelling of the teeth bar. When it is very hard, particularly in buffalo, it also comes, and we have studied that. We did not find any infectious agent in that, but in many cases, they respond to some this corticosteroid, some antihistaminics we have tried. In those cases, they may be respond with that. But otherwise, it is some changes at the muscular level in the teeth wall. It is not the intramammary infections. So corticosteroids and antihistaminics, sometimes they do work in these cases.
Thank you, sir. The next question, which has been asked by not less than 25 people, and I don't find there's a need to reply back, but I'll put it before the group. And even Dr. Bansal cannot reply on that. How can we differentiate mastitis from seeing the color or seeing odor? I don't think that is possible.
I will say from the color or from the odor. I have told you this percute cases. There it is a clear cut. When it is a redness, hot, painful to touch, and sometimes we immediately received blood test clue, clear buttery blood test clue. So these are the percute cases. And for color, you can say in case of staphylococcus, because I told you practically we receive mainly in other mild cases, other cure cases, they are almost 80% cases, they are due to staphylococcus. And when it is a percute cases, it is totally differentiated. And other they are staphylococcus cases. And in staphylococcus cases, you will receive only fine flocules in the milk, not like thick shreds and like milk, and milk yield will be less effective in staphylococcus mastitis. Then, we can differentiate this in this way, depending upon the consistency of the milk and effect on the milk yield and what is the inflammation. And others, like in case of other cases, if we are receiving, although very rare, this mycoplasma or all that, so there will be some flocules, yellowish flocules in the watery discharge that can be there. But practically for these cases, so we can treat in these cases. So either we have to treat it as a percute case or cured case or as mild case. If we are not getting much effect on the milk yield, but not much consistency changes in the milk. This means this is a mild minor organism, and then we can go for intramammary therapy alone. Now, if there is a more decrease in the milk yield, more flakes, more shoots are in the milk, so then we should consider it is a due to the Streptococcus mastitis, and we should treat both combination therapy. And if it is a per-acute cases, I have already explained, then we have to go for the intensive therapy.
What sir means to say is that the integrity and the swelling part can take you to what type of condition it is, and then you can correlate with the organism. Yeah. The next question, sir, is on when to use a teeth siphon ideally. Sure. What benefits can a teeth siphon give us?
When you use teeth siphon, I told you, when there is some nadu or some minor obstruction at the tip of the teeth or in the mid of the teeth, so then it can be used. We can keep the teeth siphon in the teeth or in the pleat plug for a few days, and it may make the passes, and then it may, but we have to follow the complete sterilization. We have to use multiple teeth siphons. We have to boil it and then for the use of next use, or alternatively, our people, they are also using this some plastic siphons, some pipes, then they keep it and then sterilization and then keep it. Then we can use it. Teeth siphon, or sometimes there is a teeth, one condition, teeth spider at the end of the there. Sometimes we report the cases when the cow is calved, or even we get the some few streaks of milk, then it stops, then again filled, again stops, then this is called teeth spider. At the end of the teeth, there is some thin membrane, so that can be broken with this teeth siphon, that can be used there also. Next, please.
Sir, any guidelines from you? From your end for treating environmental mastitis?
So environmental mastitis, I discussed.
Environmental mastitis.
Yeah. Environmental mastitis, I told you these are the, this bacteria, which I discussed in per-acute mastitis, that is environmental mastitis, that is causing due to the environment also. First is the prevention is the better, that we keep the, particularly during coming months, July, August, we have to keep the animals clean and dry, possibly. Then as long as we, but it is not possible always, and we have to, we can get that cases, environmental mastitis cases, and they are causing per-acute cases, and when we get per-acute cases, I have told you intensive therapy, we have to go for immediate therapy, removal of, frequent removal of milk, oxytocin use, then parenteral therapy, fluid therapy, normal saline, parental antibiotics, combination of antibiotics, then anti-inflammatory, this non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, multivitamins. So that is the case where we can treat with environmental, as I discussed with the per-acute cases.
Sir, another question is on udder edema. They say, how do we treat udder edema, and does it lead to mastitis? Is it correlative?
Yeah, udder edema, mostly we have seen this udder edema occur particularly in heifers in the first covers, and when they are kept more time. So udder edema, normally in case of cases of the udder edema, we did not find any bacterial infections. Udder edema, we have to differentiate, it fits on the pressure. For this, we have to do, we have to give the exercise to the animal every day. Then we have to do the milking, and then we have to use the some diuretics. Then we have to give some supportive therapies. Like local massage, I have already discussed with some local ointments are available, some Ayurvedic are available. From your concern, their ointments are available. We have to give this, then vitamins and minerals. In the long run, it can take the, to, if we are not treating and if we are putting pressure on the milk, and then it may lead to the damage to the others. Otherwise, massage of the udder, using these ointments, diuretics, then exercise, and slowly and slowly we can go for the control of this udder edema. So usually there is no need of antibiotic in these cases, and usually there is no infection in these cases. We have to take, we have to simply manage by these things.
Sir, what are the bacteria or organisms involved when we have blood in the milk?
Blood in the milk. Normally I told you galactorrhagia, we do not find any bacteria. If it is a stalling, this is a post-calving, we do not find any. And if it is a blood and milk and there is an effect on the milk yield and other, then in blood and milk, I told you it comes mostly in case of acute cases. Then water, blood and comes in those cases. Otherwise, normally we did not find blood. Or whenever we find, many times we get cases, there is an injury. When fresh blood is coming into the milk, there is some injury to the teeth. Maybe due to the by the feet of the another animal or due to some falling or otherly. So many cases, when frank blood is coming, there is some injury in the teeth. So that we have to treat it as a injury. We have to give the antibiotics, we have to give the anticoagulants like that. We have to give the we have to coagulants, we have to use these therapies.
Sir, any protocol that you recommend for handling coliform mastitis in the field, including endotoxins in utilization?
Protocol for coliform mastitis I say with these cases, because they occur very suddenly and very frequently, particularly these cases occur in the post-calving period. And in July, August month, within 3 to 5 days of most of the cases, they occur within the first month of calving, and that too within 3 to 5 days of calving. So we have to, farmer has to be advised to keep special care of those cases during that periods. And then we have to avoid any wetting and moisture conditions under the animal. And thirdly, during this post-parturient period and dry period, we have to recommend immunomodulation. We have to give the immunomodulators, like I discussed in my previous lecture, that we have to use the vitamins, minerals, and these supplements as a preventive measure, they should be used. And second, management is, as and when you receive the information, it should be immediately handled. It should be without any delay, it should be immediately treated. And for that, we have to advise the farmers, we have to do the extension activities, and doctors, they have to take it seriously, and they have to go to the immediately for the treat, and we have to do the intensive therapy for that. So by that, we can prevent, although this vaccine in developed country, they are coming, we do not have any vaccine. But when we do, we have all these following tea dipping, we are following dry therapy, we are giving immunomodulators, we are giving proper nutrition to the animal during dry period. By this, we will be able to control this occurrence of these cold of cases.
Thank you, sir. The next question is, concentrate feeding goes up during the last semester. Is there a correlation of the same with mastitis? Any nutritional guidelines that you would like to give for reducing mastitis by reducing or changing any diet in the last semester of pregnancy?
That is in the last semester of pregnancy, I will say you that nutritional diet should be used preferably as a whenever we use concentrate, it as a total mixed ration. Scientifically, it is recommended that it should be used as a total mixed ration. Because when we are using alone, it will be leading to the acidity and then prone to the laminitis and to the metritis and mastitis also. So scientifically, I can say at point of nutrition, from nutrient point of view, whenever we have to use, it should be used as a total mixed ration. And secondly, along with this, we should use the, as I told you, we should not stop the mineral mixture. Sometimes from nutrition point of view, people, they recommend that now we do not need any mineral mixture or vitamins in the supplementation because animal is dry, animal is not giving milk, it does not need the calcium, it does not need the mineral mixture. So as I told you that they need more mineral mixture, more vitamins during dry period, we should add to that during that period, concentrate, as I already told.
So what Bansal sir wants to say is during the last period of pregnancy, you may reduce on the calcium, which is a known fact for preventing postpartum complications, but do not reduce on mineral intake and vitamin intake broadly. Sir, the last question and one of the questions which comes from everyone is, can we treat fibrostudder, gangrenous mastitis? What is the therapy for the same?
Fibrostudder, I told you, in fibrosis, when there is a complete fibrosis, or when there is, it depends upon the degree of the fibrosis. First, when there is a cord in the fibrosis, when it needs some surgery, it cannot be treated. I have already told you, when there is a large, only small nodule of fibrosis, it can be managed by use of teat plug, by use of teat siphon or like. And if it is a complete fibrosis, So it cannot be treated, it cannot be cured, but people are trying homeopathy. I told you already, people told that they have used calcarea form, like they have used the silica, but they are getting some response. But I don't know, because actually we have not tried homeopathy, that to which level this milk yield is restored and to which level this fibrosis is eliminated. But in my view or in my experience, whatever we have seen, this fibrosis, once it is formed, it is never cured. Like in human beings, we have to go for the operation. We have to eliminate the tumor. Otherwise, we have to, any fibroma. Otherwise, we have to go with the medicine. So fibrosis, it does not, in my view, it does not have any treatment, and it does not have any surgery, successful surgery for this case. It can be a theoretical, it can be experimental that we do it and in few cases, but practically it is not an option.
I think we have a long array of questions which we'll take up. I'll say to the audience that whatever questions we have missed now, we'll try to send it to Dr. Bansal and he'll try to address onto it and we'll send it on mail to you. We also confirm that we'll send you the presentation on mail as per Dr. Bansal's agreement on sharing on that. So that way we are committed on to it. So thank you all for being there. Thank you, Dr. Bansal, for being a part of the webinar and sharing his expertise on mastitis. Again, saying it to the audience, whoever has missed and wants to recap can log into the same area after half an hour and you'll have the recorded version available for the day for your better learning. Thank you all, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Nitin, and thank you, the participants. Thank you very much.
Sir, live stop kar diya maine.